Welcome, everybody. I do have some notes. I want to make sure I get this right. This is a very important event. Good evening. This first part I don't need notes for. I'm Mike Moretti. I'm with Silicon Valley Bank. And we're extremely pleased to be part of this great event with CSNYC. And also to the support and for the program, Computer Science for All. This is great stuff. Just quickly on Silicon Valley Bank, we are a bank that focuses on technology companies and the venture capital firms that invest in them. And we are thrilled with what we see going on in the New York tech scene. The growth, the success stories, the validation of the whole market sector, it's really been rewarding for us. So we love what we're seeing. However, as we know, one of the challenges that the tech scene has is, and will continue to be, making sure we have enough tech talent to support this growth. So one of the things from our side that we are thrilled at seeing is what the city of New York, as well as the private sector, getting together, taking some significant steps to create and this Computer Science for All program. And just in case, for any of those who don't know about it, it's a 10-year, $80 million program that the plan is to teach all computer science education to all New York City students. So we're thrilled by that. This is a huge goal, and I'll tell you, it's off to a great start. So, also, speaking of computer science, I'm also very pleased to be able to introduce our speaker for tonight, Paul Ford. Paul is a writer, programmer, editor, and also co-founder of Postlight, which is a New York City software agency that creates internet platforms for web and mobile products. Paul's also been an editor at Harper's Magazine, and we're also on NPR's All Things Considered. In June, earlier this year, he wrote an entire issue of Bloomberg Businessweek to explain what is code, which is a pretty incredible article, about 38,000 words. Incredible. To check out what he's up to now, Paul writes regularly for Medium's The Message, and he has a column in the New Republic about databases called Big Data. He's also writing a book about web pages, which is going to be published later this year. And for fun, Paul likes to build content management systems. So give you a little insights there on Paul. Overall, he loves talking about technology. He loves explaining how it works. And with that, Paul Ford.
Thank you. Hello. Hello, hello, hello. Okay, let me get my clicker. I feel naked without it. It's got a little green thing going. Ha! Thank you for coming out. It's a privilege to be here. It's a topic dear to my heart. The idea of building a New York City where technology is a first-class citizen in the public schools is really amazing, and there's so much work going into this. And one of the things, when I was talking to CSNYC, it's a lovely organization and just great to work with. And when I was talking with them, we were talking about what I could discuss. And one of the things that's been very interesting to me, I recently started a company, and the company is called Postlight. And I'm in a position for the first time in my life with my co-founder of really needing to identify talent and to think about people who should come and work with us because we're growing. And I realized that I didn't have a model. I didn't actually have any idea what talent really was. And so that's what this talk is about. It's a very broad talk about what talent is. And I hire in three categories. I hire for engineers and designers, particularly for the web and mobile products, so interaction designers and product managers who make the apps and make the systems work. And so I started interviewing people, and I just realized I wasn't able to fully identify where their skills were. And so then I was like, well, what is talent? And there are other talents, of course. There's writing, there's the sciences, there's sculpture, there's photography, right? You know, we talk about talent a lot in our world. And I went to the Oxford Unabridged English Dictionary. And it says, this is a little dry, power or ability of mind or body viewed as something divinely entrusted. That's worth noting. God shows up a lot in discussions around talent, which is tricky in an interview. Divinely entrusted for use and improvement, considered either as one organic whole or as consisting of a number of distinct faculties, not useful for interviewing an engineer. And then, of course, there's the concept of 10,000 hours, which was popularized by Malcolm Gladwell in his book Outliers. And I think it was that one, it was Outliers. And the idea is that you do something for 10,000 hours and you're going to get good at it, which kind of makes sense, right? Like, that's how you make an expert. That's how you make somebody amazing. But then the question is, what will inspire anyone to spend that much time on something? How do they get to do that? How do you get those 10,000 hours to perfect your golf swing or learn to be a really good JavaScript programmer? And then I started looking around online, and I encourage everyone to do this because the online space around talent is completely insane. Here's a way to measure and enable improved performance with retail salespeople. Here's Medium. If you go to medium.com, big blogging platform, there's probably 20,000 articles about talent. And there's a lot of these things. There's a lot of people looking at clouds, a lot of kids with violins. This is a big one. There's this guy. He's talented. He's up to all kinds of stuff. And then there's this, like, always a focus on hard work. People bring that back in, like, hard work, better than talent, which, come on, of course. A lot of overhead shots of groups of mostly white people using LinkedIn, Estonian talent, a lot of shots on the beach, how to succeed without talent, what's it worth? And then that thing right there you saw go by, there's somebody holding a little tree. That's a big thing. So that's how some people are talking about talent, but it's never really defined. It's just like, how do you go get it? How do you apply it to your crappy thing that you're doing? And so then the true face of reality in our world is, I'm convinced, inside of Google Images. And these are little statements about talent, and I swear to God, I think this is the true nature of the internet, is these little rectangles with statements, because I just take a minute. Every one of those is a different quote about the nature of talent and what it all means. And there's a lot of, like, you know, do it with passion or not at all, or a lot of definitions about hard work and a lot of God. Again, God shows up a lot. And again, that's not practical. Whether you believe in God or not, it's difficult to use him in a definition when you're assessing someone's skills. So, is talent God-given, product of 10,000 hours, related to human capital, the product of genetics? I read one book from the 60s that said it was related to maternal narcissism. If you have a very narcissistic mother, you end up very talented. I'm sure you're all looking inside of yourselves right now and wondering if you need to call home. So, oh, sorry, quick reading, which I hope to God I still have in my pocket. I'm working on a book, and I have a little section about talent as I'm trying to figure it out that I will read to you now. Ooh. Here is a trick that I have learned from managing projects. I've shared it with other managers, and they've reported back that, sure, it works okay. Let's say you're working with a graphic designer to get them to build you a website, a good designer, a talented one, and you need them to make something for you. A web page, or even a graphic that goes on a web page. But the designer's having problems. He or she says, look, I'm sorry, it's just going to be late. I have other projects. I have other responsibilities. It's complicated. There are exigencies, and my cat died, and I can't focus, and my children, and my health condition. And you can't just force this. There's a research phase. I'm waiting to hear back from the photographer, and I need the real copy, and I need the branding guide, and they changed Photoshop again. And I'm waiting for some books to arrive, and the grid's off, and we need to consider how it's going to work on a mobile phone. And my wife has the flu, and purple's wrong. I'm waiting for Time Warner. I thought I'd be able to work in an open plan office, but I can't, and there's all this noise, and the light has a red tint, and my headphones sound tinny in one ear, and it's throwing me off, and my chair has a leftward tilt, and it's causing all of my designs to trend leftwards, and my fiance has rickets, and my daughter is sick, and my marriage is failing, and I should never have said yes to this, because I should have known that I would create only more emptiness and vacuum in the world, for I am history's worst monster. I am the reason that nothing is good. I have created only failure ever. Everywhere I go, I am a machine that eats pocky and excretes despair. But if I could have one more week, I can get it for you. Now, just to open up the lousiest program you can find for doing graphic design, and my PowerPoint is actually pretty good for this. I'm sorry. And don't think very much. Just do the design for the designer, right? Just get in there and without shame, do the absolute best you can. That's critical. An email over the product with these words. I know you're under a lot of pressure, but if you could just give me a few minutes of feedback, I'll do my best to get it done. And this will generate, I swear to God, this will generate the desired effect. I've done this. The designer will immediately switch from total despair into a state of panicked revulsion and nausea, for which the only possible cure is to take the atrocity, the offense to taste and form that you have produced and sit down huffing and take that nightmare that you've produced, throbbing in the corner of her eye like a coming migraine, and do the work that you asked her to do 45 days ago in about 6 hours. At the end of which will come a state of calm rapture and a sort of amnesia, the entire span of time during which things where nothing was getting done suddenly chalked up to the process. And now you've solved two problems. You got the work done so that you can move forward with your responsibilities, and you gave the talented person a sense of superiority and relief from her own fear of failure. That's the nature of talent. One sits around terrified to get started for fear of failing until the risk that someone else will do the work incorrectly sends you into such a state of frustration, annoyance, and jealousy that it gets done. So if you want something done wrong, do it yourself, and the right person will soon appear to complain. Thank you. Quick move in another direction. Questions of form. What is form? It's a well-understood set of constraints. One of my favorite forms in the world is that of the apple pie contest, another thing I encourage you to Google. There are rules for apple pie contests, and they are very serious. Are nuts allowed? Yes. Bacon? Come on, no meat pies here, folks. This is from the Bucktown Apple Pie Contest in Chicago, but this one here, Deerfield Farmers Market, there's hundreds of these. And the perfect pie, it turns out, just about everybody shares this definition. 10% appearance, 40% crust and filling, 50% overall flavor and taste. So there are these rules, there's this consensus, there's these set of norms about the perfect pie. And it goes back to the 1300s. This is a recipe from 1381. Take good apples and good spices and figs and raisins and pears, and when they are well abraid, colored with saffron well, and do it in a coffin, do it forth to bake well, and there you get your apple pie. So we've been working on rules for apple pies and good apple pies, or in this case, tartars and apples, for 500 plus years, 600 years. And there's a wonderful quote, I use this in almost every presentation I give, but it just comes back to me in a thousand different contexts, and it's from William Morris, who was a great British sort of everything. He was an architect and a painter, and he started a press. And in the late 1800s, he was very prominent. And he said, "You can't have art without resistance in the materials." He was looking for, you know, rules about form. Resistance, pushback, is where the art happens. It's not necessarily in the unfettered creative work that you might do, but rather in being aware of the rules and the boundaries. And that's one of the ways you can make a really good apple pie, is to know where the limits are in apple pie-ness. Here's another great example, I think, of constraints in action. These are to the point that on the bottom left there, you've actually got a cat jumping to get the fish in the other coffee cup. Like, they've pushed past the boundaries of the coffee cup. And are just going, like, you know, and which I love, right? Because the restraints were there, the resistance in the materials. And somebody said, "Well, what if I just put two cups together?" And then on the top right, you can actually see there's a digital latte printer, which is just so lame compared to the cup jumping out. But resistance in the materials, working with this is impressive. This wouldn't be as impressive on pencil and paper, but in foam, a cat jumping is an unbelievable accomplishment. Great quote from Martha Graham, the great choreographer. "No artist is pleased. There's no satisfaction whatever at any time. There's only a queer divine dissatisfaction that keeps us marching and makes us more alive than the others." So that's how she sees art, that kind of frustration. And this from Ira Glass, from NPR. "For the first couple years, you make stuff. It's just not that good. It's trying to be good. It has potential. But your taste, the thing that got you into the game, is still killer, and your taste is why your work disappoints you. A lot of people never get past this phase." So taste is key to getting things done. So trying to synthesize all this, trying to put it all back, I came up with a working definition. Talent is the demonstrated ability of an individual when they perceive errors of form, things that could be better, to take specific actions to correct those errors. Or talent is what annoys you. And I've been applying this in my world, and I've been looking around, and I've been seeing examples. And if you look, here's the weblog handbook, a book about how to do screenplays, how to write a movie, how to write a book this weekend. There's a whole industry telling us how to get this stuff done. Where are the boundaries? What are the forms? What are the rules that you need to apply in order to get good? How to read a book, how to paint like the old masters, how to make computer programs. There's resistance and there's rules here too. It's not just sitting down and like spewing code everywhere. There's a way to do it right. There's a cultural understanding. White Space, this very graphic designer, White Space is Not Your Enemy, How to Write Like a Journalist, Chicago Manual of Style. Like, many of us probably work with these different forms and rules, and you almost forget that they're there, that you just take them for granted. But these are arbitrary, they're cultural. Elements of typographic style, elements of journalism. And people take this seriously. These are HTML tags. They've had them written onto their body, right? And not just one person did this. And then this is actually the Photoshop command bar. This person also had it tattooed on their body. This is how closely we get connected to the tools and the forms that we live inside. And one thing I've noticed is that the world we're in New York City, you know, San Francisco and the Bay Area, they make the boxes. You know, they go out there and they're working and they're coding and they make the boxes. And New York City has been filling them in. And we're good at it. We're really good at filling in the boxes, but it's time for us to get better at making them. Here's another one, Tumblr, which is a New York City company, but a set of rules and rituals that got an enormous amount of input from users, millions and millions and billions of posts, by locking people down into text, photo, quote, link, chat, audio, video. And this one is huge too, 140 characters. Everyone has been learning to push back and deal with the form and the constraints of 140 characters. So I have been learning about the kinds of things that annoy different people. Engineering, engineers get very upset at what runs slow and badly structured code. Designers love a grid, they love order and a system, and product managers are looking for a clear sense of the user and are worried about a useless minimum viable product. So talent is what annoys you. Now, this is normally where I stop the talk, but I have about one or two more minutes that I really personally want to express. And I don't want to throw a curveball, but I just want to go off the script because I'm actually a fairly shy person, and I don't necessarily love public speaking. I've been learning how to do it, but this thing is important, what we're talking about here. And I think there are many teachers in the audience, there's lots of people in this audience. And you know, I moved here 20 years ago to the city, I've never left, and I love it, and I love the infrastructure, and I care about the issues that we're facing. And I've got two kids, and they're in pre-K right now, and they're gonna go to PS 139 in a year, and we live in Ditmas in Brooklyn. And I asked myself, what do I want them to learn about technology? Do I want them to build apps? I mean, honestly, right now they're four, it's twins. I want them to observe basic hygiene. That's where I'm at. But obviously, I do want them to understand computer science and technology because I want them to know how the world is really working. And I want them to understand that there's no magic in there, that this is a machine. And I want them to understand that we have computers not because of some grand plan in the universe or some magical amount of money happening somewhere, but because smart people observed interesting physical phenomena over hundreds of years, and in time they were able to create these amazing transistor-based technologies that can do so many things. And I want them to understand that there are reasons for why these things work. And I want them to understand that there's a living in technology, absolutely, but that it takes practice and discipline. And I could give them that at home because I have that set of skills, but it'll be wonderful if they can get there together with their peers. That's a thing that I'm very hopeful about, and if the public schools are part of that, because this is a new world and it's not going away. And what worries me is that technology is so pervasive that it's become invisible. And when something's invisible, it's easy to forget how powerful it is. TV ran this country for decades, and it seemed like the TV networks were almost a government unto themselves. And who could ever make their own TV show? And now we have YouTube, but we also have YouTube, which is a big thing unto itself. Who could afford to publish their own newspaper? You know, for the first half of my life, it was a big deal to get a letter published. And now we're almost all newspapers ourselves. And I grew up in a very chaotic home, I think is the simplest way to put it. A lot of money problems, a lot of family problems, but it just so happened that I lived close to a company called Commodore. It was an early personal computer player. And as a result of living near, we always had computers in our schools. We had these Commodore machines everywhere. And I happened to be interested in them. I wasn't necessarily interested in programming or in coding. I was interested in that power that was in that machine. I could do things with it that seemed very adult, like write something and print it out. And, you know, as like a 10-year-old, 11-year-old. And I only got interested in how they work much later. But I had this chaotic life, but a very paradoxical access to technology. And my business partner here, Rich Ziade, is in this audience tonight, and he grew up in Bay Ridge. He came over from Lebanon as a kid, and one of the things we bonded over when we first met was that Commodore 64, because that was his first computer too. And that machine was so rational. And this whole world around you as a kid was so crazy and so chaotic, but the computer was actually calm. And that's actually what it came to represent to me. That's why I stayed in technology, because the world would be chaotic, but the tech was not. And it's interesting because when we hear about Silicon Valley, a lot of the times we hear about the word disruption, disruption, disruption. And in the educational system, it's a very loaded word. A disruptive child is a problem child, and we worry about them. And those are the kids who need the most help. And what I hear out in the world are a lot of stories about people who are excluded from technology. It's a big narrative that's out there. And young women, people of color, people with different abilities, people of lesser means. And what I think when I hear that is that these are the people who need what the computer has to offer the most, because it will always listen to them, it will always behave the same way, and it will always do exactly what you tell it to. And you need to learn the how and the why of it for it to mean something. But technology is this one place in human life where you can have control. And it can sound very creepy when it's a large organization or a very rich person telling you about technology and control. But trust me, when you're a single individual and the world around you seems crazy, having that control over a computer and making it do interesting things is incredibly empowering. So the goal here tonight is to help people be more than users, turn them into creators, turn them into critics. And it's going to take many, many years. But I guess what I'm saying is, if you're going to be in a position to help children see and understand the forms and the boundaries that are inside of the computer, if you're going to give them a huge opportunity when you show them where those limits are, what the rules are of computing, and then they'll learn to work within those boundaries and learn how to work with tech, and that is really worth doing on its own merits. And I know there's a very big conversation we're all having right now about New York City being competitive with the rest of the country and the importance of technology to the economic well-being of America. And that I respect that conversation. It does matter very much. But if you're out there teaching kids to be annoyed by the fact that the computer isn't behaving the way they wanted, and giving them the opportunity to react to that, to address that knowledge, to make their own software, then you'll be doing this extraordinary thing. You'll be giving them talent. The focus isn't just on making more millionaires. Millionaires are great. There's many here in the audience tonight. But there's other things to do with a computer than make money. We want to teach people to build, but teach them to debug as well. Teach them that the world of technology is often fragile, full of false assumptions, and show them that they can challenge those assumptions and that they can do it by coding themselves. And I know we don't talk about it that way. We talk about STEM and the sciences and the global digital economy, but when I think about technology, I think about the people it brought into my world. And I think about the opportunity it gave me to make myself a better and more empathetic human. And I hope we also focus on that part, on the individual student learning how to be more powerful and self-assured and, yes, more talented in the world of technology, because I assure you that if we do, the global digital economy will take care of itself. Thank you. Now it is my privilege to bring to the stage for, and he will tell you both who he is and what he's going to talk about, Anil Dash.
I want to open by saying I can attest to Paul's theory of annoyance because Paul is a very accomplished computer programmer and an incredible writer. And I am a okay writer and a lousy coder. And a few years ago, we were talking about an idea. Some of you might have read Paul's piece about the web is a customer service medium and this idea of why wasn't I consulted as an animating force behind interaction on the internet. And we actually started talking about it. And I said, you know, Paul, if you don't write it, I'm going to write a lousy version of this piece that we're talking about. And 24 hours later, a fully edited, produced, excellent, incredible version of that piece was live on Paul's site. So the theory of annoyance as a driving force for talent is true. And Paul and I connected on a lot of levels, actually, over the years, one of which is that I grew up, too, in the Commodore zone of Pennsylvania with a Commodore 64 computer. And the difference for me is that even as a young kid, to walk into a room and assert that I was a computer programmer, most folks would say, well, an Indian kid, that sounds kind of plausible, right? Like there was sort of not a huge leap to make to be credible in that. And in fact, I never went to college. Right out of high school, started a tech company that was doing consulting around computers and never had trouble convincing somebody that I had technological skills even before I did. This is not likely to be the experience of most of the kids in this city when they start to engage with the economy around technology, the opportunities around technology. And there's a lot of reasons why. I want to dive into a couple things. The first is, in this era that Paul and I and several other people I'm sure will allude to of 20 and 30 and further more years back in the past, technology was an interest and it was an area of study, but it was not an industry intrinsically. And so it was an area for creative expression and self-expression. And in fact, the way that we made a lot of our relationships and connections was the idea that we were going to team up with somebody and hack or code or build something together. It was a weekend project. It's what you did with your friends. It was not different in kind than two kids that are both trying to learn their instruments and have a little jam session together, and maybe they form a band when they get to high school. Or the folks that are like, well, we practice drawing together and then we do art projects together. It's an expressive tool as opposed to merely a way to capture value that exists in the economy. And that is a narrative that we have mostly abdicated in our conversations about technology these days. There are a lot of reasons why. I'm not going to get into all of them, but some of the implications of that are very, very important. Perhaps the biggest one is think of how much of our experience of life today is mediated by technology. The average person that owns a smartphone, by the end of their life, will have spent about 3 years of their life with their thumb on the glass of that phone. And I'm above average in this regard, phone usage, so I'm going to be looking back on my, you know, deathbed, like, why did I spend 5 years in Instagram? And that's going to be a lot of us. And now that's one issue when we think about like how we use our time. But then the other thing that comes to mind for me is, I'm sure you've all had this experience. You flip on the TV, you're watching some show, you say, who's that actor? Man, I think I know who that is. Let me go Google it. I'm going to go look it up. And in like 3 seconds, you know every movie that person's ever been in, the commercials they did at the beginning of their career, and, oh, I didn't know they did this movie with that other person. It's effortless. It's instant. Meanwhile, if you spend all day checking your Facebook, looking something up on Google, looking at photos on Instagram, all these other apps that you use, there's no idea who made them. There's no credit screen. We used to have about pages on software back like, you know, 10 or 20 years ago, like on the website or maybe in some like menu that would be buried away. But there's none of that. No credits roll at the end when you close the Instagram app on your phone. And there's no way to know who made it. One of the immediate implications of that is we know who gets credit. Like Mark Zuckerberg probably did not write a single line of code for that app that's on your phone that lets you connect to Facebook. But we sure all know his face, and he's done a lot of great things, but we don't know who actually made that app. And what happens when we don't know who creates our technology is first, the people who get erased are the most vulnerable. We lose mostly, again, as Paul said, women, people of color, anybody who's marginalized, people of different ability, they're the first ones whose names are not going to be listed in the credit reel when we look at our technology. And the implications of that are even more profound when we think about introducing our kids to technology. It is so powerful for me. I mean, you know, basically the contemporary era, Indian families have been able to immigrate to the US for about 50 years. And this year, with Aziz Ansari's show, was the first time we had an Indian male lead on a TV show ever. And it's great. It's like, go on Netflix, go watch it, it's fun. But what was striking to me was, I sort of didn't exist before this year, right? I'm somebody that loves pop culture and loves media, and I just arrived. 50 years in, we finally have some representation. And that's not a new concept. You all say, yeah, sure, basic media literacy is representation matters, and we have to be able to see ourselves, and that those representations be nuanced and rich, and these things impact culture and have meaning to people. I spend a lot more time in my apps than I do watching Netflix, though. And in this particular case, I'm very fortunate. I can look at the CEO of Google or of Microsoft or Adobe and say, there's an Indian dude, I'm good, I got my guy. Most kids can't. Most kids can't see themselves there. And most kids don't know that somebody like them was a contributor to the app that they use every day. And then, of course, there are these huge biases that exist in the tech industry today. Part of the reason they don't know is because sometimes that isn't true. That isn't who had that opportunity. That isn't who had the skills to be part of the tech industry. That's a familiar issue. I want to pinpoint one particular outcome of those biases and of those flaws in the current ways technology is used that's really, really profound, which is that the technology we use, the software we use, bakes in the values of the people who create it. It's intrinsic to the choices we make in that software. When Facebook launched, they had an option to show your relationships and how you're related to people, and you could say for your significant other, it's complicated. I'm sure a bunch of you probably remember that. And of course, it was created as, you know, a private club for folks in the Ivy League who were probably hooking up with each other, and like there isn't any social stigma to saying it's complicated about your relationship with someone. But I think about, you know, my parents had an arranged marriage, and they're 46 years in as of like 2 weeks ago, and they're doing great. But if I had listed it's complicated as my relationship status for my family in India, they would have been like, wow, that's a profound statement. Like, we're 400 years into arranged marriages and your thing's complicated? And so it would be a little bit of a leap. And especially, you know, in communities where you don't express those kinds of things publicly, even having that option in the list of choices for a relationship says this software is not for you, right? And this plays out in a lot of different other ways. There's an app called Postmates that's like delivery. You can order things delivered to your house, and they do a good job of it, and people come and, you know, make some money delivering things, I'm sure. And they changed one menu option about how you tip the person that makes the delivery, and they changed the default to no tip. And long story short, the implication for a lot of the people who are delivering packages and goods for the company was about a 30 to 40% cut in their take-home pay, which, you know, there's a lot of reasons that sort of thing happens. They did undo the change and make things right, which is great. But I think about the cultural assumptions of the person making that one menu item, that one button in that app, and that, what are the odds that person's ever worked a job that relied on tips as part of your wages? Pretty slim. Pretty low, right? And what does it mean that so much of what we think of as successful technology and successful products and culture are made by people who go from very good schools or very privileged onto very good universities like Stanford, directly from there onto campuses of these giant tech companies where every need is taken care of for them? And you know, literally, they've got a shuttle bus. They ride a bus like they're going to school to work, and the bus has snacks on it. I'm sure the snacks are great. I'm happy for them, but it's not actually a way to understand and really live at an empathetic level with the problems that people face. And so I think about those are really profound structural issues that are wrong with the technology and impact culture in broad ways. And the one thing that makes me so excited and that has been such an animating force for me being involved and the tech community, particularly here in New York over the past several years, is that the folks who are going to fix it are the kids in this town. I see them, I talk to them, and you know, I think of the six-year-old girls in Alphabet City that I got to watch using their smartphones have a better mastery of how to use contemporary technology than the CEOs of the Fortune 50 companies in Midtown that I see trying to use the same devices. They have an advantage. There is this brief window here where they can do a thing that is magical and powerful. And all we have to do is give them the resources to be able to take that and fix these bugs, these little tiny bugs that we think are a bug in software, but are actually gigantic bugs in culture. And so that's why I'm incredibly excited to be here with all of you today and really inspired by the work you're all going to do. Thank you.
Let me welcome to the stage Stacey Mulcahy.
How do I follow that up? I don't even know. Just get off stage right now. I've had Game of Thrones in my head all day. Everyone know the theme song? But it's more like, what is code? What is code? Do, 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 all day long. It's horrible. So I'm a technical evangelist with Microsoft. Yes, PowerPoint is a perfectly great tool to, work in and suggest things your designers should do. I will level you up, Paul. You should use Comic Sans and only neon green. That for sure will communicate what you're trying to do, and that designer will fix it immediately. So what is talent? And we talk a lot about it. And I think we talk a lot about like trying to work with all these talented people. And it's kind of interesting because some of the stuff I've heard just previously really resonates with me personally. I work with kids a lot, and I don't do it as part of my job. I do it because I volunteer my time. And I'm really passionate about working with kids. And we have so many organizations in New York right now. And most of them, I'm going to be very honest, are focused towards getting girls to code, right? Getting girls to be interested, getting these girls who are casual gamers. And I think those organizations are great. But I also think that we're doing a disservice to everyone if we're ignoring also the boys, right? Because I think it's important for a young girl to see herself in me, as we've talked about. But I also think it's just as important that that young boy sees that I have value and that I could teach that person something and that I could inspire that person to be something else. Probably the best endorsement I've ever had in my life was I was working with some of the Boy Scouts, and we were 3D printing boats, and they were doing a regatta. And one of the kids, you know, I was helping him with this Raspberry Pi, and he went over to his buddy, and his buddy's like, oh yeah, no, I need to get this going. He's like, oh, just go ask Stacy. Stacy knows. Stacy can help you. And he was like, no. And he's like, no, really, Stacy knows. Go. And I was like, that's better than a LinkedIn endorsement any day to me. Like, I got a little 11-year-old on my side here. Like, I'm rocking it, you know? And so for me, when I start to think about, like, talent, and I start to think about what does that mean for all of us, I start to think about opportunity. And I think about not just someone who's reached that level, but how can you open that door? Because for me, when I came out of school, I had no idea that programming was an option. I was told straight out, you probably, you know, your marks are great, you could do this, but you don't want to go into computer science, you know? And it totally made that opinion of computer science very narrow for me, and I still feel that way about computer science. When we talk about the term computer science, I feel like we're limiting what that means for a lot of people. And for kids, I feel like we're almost more limiting it. And so when I try to think about code, when I try to think about people say coding is the new literacy, when I think about those kind of things in programming, I really, really like to think about what are ways that they can use this to express themselves? And it could be about art. It could be about, you know, making a software program. It could be, you know, anything that they want to do, but that is one more tool in their tool belt. That is, you know, their Word or their, you know, database or anything that they interface on a daily basis that they got to do. And so I think about those opportunities that we can, kind of give to people. How many people have done Hour of Code this week? Anyone do an Hour of Code? Yeah, Hour of Code, right? And again, going back and sitting with someone, I sat with a child, I got buddied up. I don't know if it was intentional or not. with a child who had special needs, and we sat down and we were in processing and we made the screen fill up with lines and we would change the color palettes, and it was probably the best moment of my entire week, if not my entire year. Because all of a sudden, a child who people had already kind of just put into a box, compartmentalized, who might not have even picked up, you know, some of these things, was trying something new, right? And so when it comes to talent, we often look at, like, what are the top shining stars and how can we hold on to them and employee retention and all that stuff. And I think that's super, super important. But if you're not fostering the right environments for people to even explore what annoys them, for example, or explore how to, like, you know, self-express those ideas and try to fix what annoys them, then you're already shutting the door on a bunch of people, right? And in New York, when you look at all the kids who come out and you look at all of these programs that are in place, it's just so easy to start slotting people into little compartments of, we need computer science, we need math, we need art, we need all this stuff. I teach game making, for example, because game making to me, I don't know if there's any gamers in the room, but to me it's an art. It's got narrative. It's got beautiful graphics. It's well thought out. There's level design. There's programming. To me, it's just like the perfect meld of every discipline you can imagine. And when I give that to a child, I'm like, here's your playground. Have at it. Choose what you want to do. And so when I think about talent, I think about a lot of people who have the spotlight on them, who you aspire to be, who do what you can't do in a way that's, you know, amazing. But I also think, you know, how did they get there, right? How did they discover what they were interested in? Because if I go back to myself when I was 18, there's no way I would have said computer science. I wanted to write, right? I was beat generation all the way, you know? Little sad Stacey, you know, emo before emo even existed. I'd do the hair thing, but I don't have it. But when I think about that person now, and I think about what I'm doing and how I transitioned, it was curiosity. And it was the ability to explore my curiosity. And so when I think about, you know, the fact that people consider me talented, I think about all those opportunities I was given, whether I was self-motivated or whether I was just curious to pursue those things. And we need to encourage that more. I give a lot of my time to teaching kids. It's embarrassing. Like, literally, I have no social life, right? It's just that bad. But when I think about what those kids are doing, and I think about, yes, like, you are going to be my boss. Like, I always see my future bosses in these kids, right? I had a kid, his name was Chase from Boston. He's actually on Kickstarter, and he's doing this little, he's making a device where you can add sound effects to your Lego. It's really cool. And he literally lights up a room, and he's going to be a CEO. He's going to be my boss. He's going to be your boss, right? And I start to look at kids in this way. One other thing I want to tell you, just to give you kind of a little bit of hope or a little bit of like, oh, that's sweet, is I was teaching Minecrafting API, and I had a five-year-old girl who was sitting beside her father coding in Python. She made two tall towers full of bricks and then made them lava towers, which was just like something I never would have thought of. She did it all by herself. I taught her the basics. She did this. And then she went around the room and she helped 11-year-old boys do it. Get it, girl. Right? So when I think about those kind of things, I think about her. I can't wait. Please, please just let time fast forward and be my boss. And I think about Chase, you know? I think about someone who's going to have a vision and direction and he's not shy and all those things. And maybe he's not going to program, but he understands the value of it. And so I think talent, I think our definition of comp sci needs to change, frankly. I know that a lot of people are like, don't say that, don't. But, you know, I think it's got to change a little because we always narrow people into a certain area. And I think that when it comes to kids and inclusivity, we got to be a little bit more open and let them run with those kind of, you know, playing ground that we can give them. That's all I got. That's it. Thank you.
And finally this evening, please welcome Chris Wiggins to the stage.
Okay, that's pretty much impossible to follow. And everybody said everything that I have to say, so good. I thought Paul set a great tone by being so very autobiographical here, and also by including not only his own history, but how his history relates to tech and to New York City. So I'll explain myself a bit by trying to be autobiographical. And there's also some common themes really woven in there in everything everybody said, including, oddly, the Commodore 64. So my dad briefly worked at Commodore, so we had lots of Commodore 64s, and briefly at Texas Instruments, so we had a TI Dimension 4 and a 99 4A, if that means anyone. So basically, I grew up with technology part of my life, although I grew up in Texas, so there wasn't quite the community that you have in a place like New York City for other nerds. And something that was formative for me was actually going to a computer camp, or I would now say a nerd camp, the summer that Tron came out. So I was 11 years old. You can figure out I'm old. But a lot of nerdy things happened that summer. And it really introduced me to the fact that coding was not something that you had to do in your own space by yourself because you're the only person who has a TI Dimension 4, but that you can make code collaborative and fun and very social. So in addition to Stacey's feeling about changing computer science, I think something that's changing rapidly now in 2016 is our vision of computers as something that you do, you know, by yourself in your basement, and that we start to see more and more about how coding can be very human. And in fact, all of the stories and all the perspectives tonight, I think that was a common theme, is just how human it was. So to bring in New York City, I came to New York City to go to college, and it was just amazing. I don't want to say anything disparaging about Texas, but it was I really have the zeal of the converted for New York City. And I've always thought of it as this place that was very disruptive in all the best senses of the word, and feel like it's been disruptive for centuries. After going to undergraduate here in New York City, I went to graduate school, which also touches on Paul's theme of the 10,000 hours, because graduate school is really like 10,000 hours. It's like working 40 hours a week for, you know, 5 days, 40 hours a day for 40 hours a week, however many hours there are, but for 5 years of it, which is why I do the math, for 5 years. And then after graduate school, I basically worked another 10 years to get tenure at Columbia. So by way of outing a bit of my biography, I'm a professor at Columbia. And there are many people here who are educators, so you know what it means to get tenure, which means that they can't fire you, no matter how crazy what you do next is. And so I thought, what should I do next? Now that I'm able to decide whatever I want to do, rather than sort of focusing on the success rubric of higher ed, every, you know, semester at a time. And I started reading a lot about how New York City, which I've thought of for years as this disruptive place, you know, centuries of disruption and just craziness, how could it be that our country did not think of New York City as the home of energetic ass kickers, to use a term that Paul Graham later used? And in particular, how do we retain the talent that we grow here? And this was really on my mind because the first 8 years of my time at Columbia were in applied mathematics, 2001 through 2008, which is a time I now refer to as the Madoff economy, where just every young person that I taught just got on the subway and went down to Wall Street to price exotic derivatives. And after I got tenured, I felt like one of the things I should do is pay penance for that and try to think about what we do to try to grow and retain the talent that we have here. So I started doing what academics do, and I started doing research about how other innovation ecosystems get that way, which meant I spent a lot of time reading about the history of Silicon Valley. And it's interesting, if you look at that history, you read a lot of literature by founders who say, well, Silicon Valley is the way it is because of the founders in the 1980s and how they founded great companies. And if you look at literature written by venture capitalists, they say Silicon Valley got that way because of the venture capitalists, you know, who made it that way in the 70s. And if you look at literature by ex-military people, they say, well, it was the ex-military funding. And of course, if you look at literature by professors about how Silicon Valley got that way, they'll say, well, it was the professors. And so that was the literature that really resonated with me. And in particular, I was really struck by how in the 40s and even in the late 30s, how much faculty had done, other than just like writing grants and making equations, to do social engineering to build a community of the people that they teach. So we think about higher ed, or at least I think of higher ed and its relationship to talent, which was Paul's theme, as the place where we identify talent. You know, higher ed admits only some people. And in fact, among faculty, we spend a lot of time thinking about talent, because like half of being a professor is peer review of the other people and who's really talented enough. But we also grow talent, you know, by teaching them stuff. But one of the things that I observed from looking at the literature of Silicon Valley is how much of it is really just the social engineering of convincing young people that it's okay to do whatever is the thing that they're working on that's really, really hard, and to set social conditions such that they meet other people who are also working on stuff really, really hard, and bring out the best in each other, and thereby bring out the best in themselves. So that was very much in my mind, thinking about Silicon Valley and also thinking about my own time in Nerd Camp, not just in when I was 11, but also in graduate school, which is sort of like one big five-year-long Nerd Camp, and how I could set, or I could work to set social conditions where people in New York City would bring out the best in each other and thereby themselves. So I didn't really know much about the startup community at the time, and I sort of shook my friend tree and managed to meet some other people that were like-minded, and long story short, I ended up co-founding Hack NY, which is a structured summer internship program in the summer and student hackathons once a semester. So at the time, in spring of 2010, there wasn't really like a student hackathon scene, but it really has taken off quite a bit. So by bringing students together in a residential experience where they spend 10 weeks working in startups and then we give them pedagogical lectures in the evening, I was trying to recreate all of what I felt like were the best parts of higher education with none of the sucky parts. And trying to give young people a chance to just say, it's okay to really want to dig deep and learn something really hard and bring out the best in each other and thereby to bring out the best in yourselves. And that is what I think Hack NY has done. It has also led to this sensation of seeing other people doing it wrong. Certainly with student hackathons, students now go to like student hackathons every weekend during the school year, and they see each other's things, and they, you know, great artists copy, and great artists steal, bad artists, actually the truth is they all steal. So they're all sort of building off of each other all the time. And really inspiring each other. And they inspire each other in ways that are very respectful. You know, you like somebody else's stuff when you build on top of it, which I will remind you is what Isaac Newton said, Isaac Newton wrote when he said, standing on the shoulders of giants. Part of what you do in a community of a community of scholars, as Fred Terman said, is you look at the people whose work you respect and you say, you are doing it wrong. Here is how you should be doing it, which I definitely think of as part of our work as scholars also. Part of our peer review is looking at literature by people I respect and just being like, you were doing it wrong. I'm going to publish a different paper, which I think does really bring out the best in all of each other while bringing out the best in ourselves. So to tie it back to the human thing, you know, we don't think about tech as a big human thing, and certainly society thinks about tech as a very dehumanizing thing. But I think Anil and Paul and certainly Stacey, and I hope I have pointed out some of the ways that tech is very human, and that particularly in higher ed, or for those of us who are educators, one of the most powerful things we can do is not just, you know, preparing a lesson plan or telling people how to integrate 1/1 + x² or inverted 2x2 matrix, but setting the conditions in which young people bring out the best in each other and thereby bring out the best in themselves. So I hope that you keep that human condition in mind. And of course, New York City, I think of as the great human experiment, right? This is not a place where we talk about how much we love the fact that we can go outside in our Lycra and get away from each other. You know, we are participating in this amazing experiment of how many millions of people can you put on one island and have us all figure out a way to get along. Which, you know, it's a very human place. So keep that in mind when you think about tech, that, you know, we as educators, a lot of what we are doing is really social engineering, and that human is really part of learning tech. And as Anil pointed out, we also must keep in mind the human element of the tech that we build. Thank you very much.
So originally we were hoping to do Q&A. We don't have time, I've been told, but I'll perch on the sofa outside of there, and I bet I can convince my three co-speakers to perch there as well, right outside the doors for a few minutes, if you guys have any questions. But what I would like to do is introduce the person without whom this would not exist at all, Fred Wilson. I'd like to bring him to the stage. And he is a managing partner of Union Square Ventures. He is the founder of CSNYC. And this is what he loves. He is a person who is building a diverse venture capital universe, which is an unusual combination of words, but in this case, it's very real. And I will get out of the way and let him speak.
So I'm the person who's keeping you all from drinks and food, so I'm gonna make this quick. I think as I was sitting upstairs, in the back, listening to all of those fantastic talks, I was thinking about Wednesday when I was in Paul's neighborhood, Ditmas, and I was at a middle school with Michael and a few other of our colleagues. And we were watching An Hour of Code, which was great. And then we went to another classroom where kids were taking something called the Software Engineering Program that a bunch of people in this room helped build. And the chancellor was there. And I don't know if any of you have met the chancellor, but she's an amazing, you know, fire plug of a woman, a grandmother. And she was saying to the kids, you know, you can take these skills and you can make software that you can charge a lot of money for. And this young sixth grader, if I could just show you the picture on my phone, I would love to do it, raised his hand as a young African-American man, and he young man, and he said, Chancellor. And she says, yes, and he says, when I make my software, I'm not gonna charge anything for it. I'm gonna give it away so everybody can use it and the world will be a better place. And I thought to myself, how the hell does he know that at sixth grade? Like, where is he reading this? And I didn't get a chance to ask him, and I'm almost tempted to go back out there and find him and figure out that, because it got to what Anil was saying. And that's, you know, I didn't get to this work by thinking about that, which is that our culture and our values are embedded in the code that we write and the software that we make. I've got there now, but I didn't get there. I originally got there by thinking we need more people to work for the companies we create. So it was like the economic imperative. But now 4.5, 5 years into this work, I've been sort of overwhelmed by the social imperative of why this work is so important. So I appreciate all of the comments I heard tonight because they encapsulate why I spend so much of my time on this. So I'm gonna just give you a couple things that I wanna run through, and then we're gonna go upstairs and have some food and drink. Okay, so a couple things. We have this incredible program called CSNYC Partners. And this work will not be as impactful as it needs to be if we can't get all of the amazing companies that you all work for and have started connected to the students who are learning computer science in the schools. So the idea behind the Partners Program is that companies, and these are all of the companies who've already joined, become a partner. And there's two pieces to it. One is that you make an annual financial commitment, and it's, you know, very small amount of money a year if you're a small company, and it's a little bit more money if you're a bigger company, and it's a little bit more money if you're a really big company, but it's not a lot of money. But it's an annual commitment that the company makes to help support the work we're doing. And then we connect your company to the students and the work we're doing, to do field trips, to have some of your employees go into classrooms, to do mentorships, and to get students who are appropriately qualified to even come in and do internships. And so it's a little bit of money and a lot of time, and it's one thing, and every company who joins gets both. So if you work for a company that you think wants to become a partner, or if you own a company that wants to be a partner, or if you have any suggestions for companies we should go after to become partners, just text your email address to us at this phone number. We hacked this together with some code, by the way. We coded this up this week using the API of a company called Twilio, which makes it super easy to do. And so all you gotta do is text an email address to this number, and we'll follow up with an email to you, and you can tell us where we got to go and find more people. But we've just gotten started, and we're going to, I think, eventually have this entire slide filled with companies that are CSNYC partners. You can also, as an individual, make a donation at CrowdRise, crowdrise.com/support-CSNYC. And that is the end, and I seem to have crashed the screen. So that's the end of my comments. I appreciate you all coming out tonight. I really appreciate our speakers, very empowering and inspirational. And everybody is invited to go upstairs. Cindy, it's just one floor up? One floor up where we're gonna have a reception. There's some food, there's some drink, and we'll all be hanging out or at least all of the CSNYC folks will be hanging out for the next hour, and that'd be a good place to ask us any questions you might have. Thank you very much.